Okay, I think as more people are sauntering in, let's just begin the session. And as people come in, they can basically join in. As you all know, the title of the session is quite pertinent to, I guess, the world we live in today, the future of liberal international order. And as a moderator, I'm supposed to say nice things about my speakers, because that's the job of a moderator. But in all honesty, we have some really good speakers in this session. And I've known two of them for a long time. Martin, I've read your book. I don't agree with all your assertions, but obviously it is one of the top bestsellers on China in the world. So it's a real honor to have met you yesterday here at the ASEAN conference. And so before we begin, I'm sure you've read all their bios. Let me just begin with a brief introduction of Francois Godement to my left. He teaches at Sciences Po. He is now the director of the Asia program at the European Council on Foreign Relations. He has been one of the oldest, dearest friends of mine from Paris for the last nearly 25 years, Francois. And he is one of France's most well-known specialists on Asia. And Canada's most renowned Asian specialist just walked in, Dr. Paul Evans. So thank you for joining us. And he is here for the ASEAN conference. He has published numerous books and articles. And in fact, his English version, what is it?
Kufulashiwa, that's China wants.
That's right. So that's coming out. And Divided Asia, the Implications for Europe. Dr. Martin Jacques, he is a senior fellow in the Department of Politics and International Studies at Cambridge, also a visiting professor at Tsinghua University. And he's done lots of interesting visiting fellowships at Renmin University, Aichi University in Japan, and he was a visiting research fellow at the Asia Research Institute at National University of Singapore. And of course, as you all know, for those of you who have not written his, read his book, he's the author of When China Rules the World, The End of the Western World, and The Birth of a New Global Order. Did you also do a TED Talk?
Yeah.
You did, right? Yes. Okay.
1.7 million.
That's right. Yeah. So he's gotten a lot of hits, and we look forward to his engaging arguments. Last but not least, on my far left, Dr. Jin Canrong, also another friend of mine from China. We last had a small mini-table discussion slash argument in a nice way in Beijing at the first Beijing forum that was sponsored by the ASEAN Institute last year. He's a professor and associate dean with the School of International Studies at Renmin University of China, currently serves as the vice president of the China National Association of International Studies, and he's also one of China's leading scholars on international issues. I run into him probably two or three times a year, mostly in international conferences, such as the Shangri-La Dialogue. So, gentlemen, we have for the next until 6:45, which leaves us a fairly ample amount of time. As you know, the topic today is what will happen to the liberal order that we have called the basic template for the last, I'd say, 50, 60 years, maybe going longer. And so what I would like to do, first of all, is to ask you one question each. So give me your straight 2-3 minute rejoinders, and then we'll continue from there. So Francois, is liberal international order dead?
No, it's a little frayed at the edge, and we have grown more ambitious. Mm. We put our norms everywhere, so it's fragmenting from within. And from outside, I would say that many people are joining the liberal order, but they don't want to contribute.
How would you define liberal international order?
That's the toughest part, because is it really liberal? Was it ever liberal? Right. And is it an order? Mm. Liberal, I don't define it by economic liberalism, mm-hmm. if only because there is a competition of models again right. today, which is happening. I don't define it purely by norms, because you need an enforcer. Mm-hmm. And whether the enforcer is multilateral or whether it's a single country, of course, it makes a hell of a difference. And also, I have to say, in all French honesty, that I admit hypocrisy. That is, as I admit double standards, I admit incremental liberal order, building blocks, You know, one of our thinkers once said that hypocrisy is vice's recognition for virtue. And therefore, I don't buy the cynical argument that the liberal order does not exist because some of the people who are in charge with enforcing it do not respect it either. But there is, of course, corrosion from within, and we have to address that too.
Okay. Martin, would you say that the liberal international order is on its deathbed, or is it going to be replaced by another non-Western liberal or non-Western international order?
Well, in one sense, I think it's sort of at its peak now.
At its peak?
Well, in the sense that there is, you know, a global system,
right,
which virtually, not every country, but virtually all countries, mm, in some degree or other, subscribe to. And this is clearly different from the previous system, which was the Cold War, which was a bifurcated system. Mm-hmm. And before that, a colonial system,
right,
where actually very few countries essentially enjoyed independence. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, then you could say this is the most successful period. But looking at it from another point of view, which is, well, actually, it's not just an abstract international liberal order, but it depends upon, I mean, nations have varying degrees of power within it. Mm-hmm. And clearly, the system that we have witnessed since 1945, at first in a bifurcated form in the Cold War, and then since the collapse of the Soviet Union in a more universal form, the dominant nation in that has been the United States, and the United States, the institutions that inform it, the way in which America behaves and so on, helps to sustain that system, mm-hmm, and underwrite it. Now, here I think is the sort of that we're coming to a big historical change. Which is that I think for various reasons, above all, on the one hand, the decline of the United States in terms of its GDP relative, mm, to global GDP, on the one hand, and on the other hand, in particular, the rise of China, but you know, in general, more generally the emerging world, but especially China, suggests to me that actually we're going to see a much bigger shift over the coming decades. I wouldn't like to put a timescale on it, but I think that's the period we're now moving into.
What would you call the emerging order?
I don't have a name for it at the moment. I mean, some people call it, you know, multipolar world and so on. If it was really a multipolar world, it would be very different from what we have now. My own guess is that the key power over time will be China in relationship to it, and that system will be in very important respects very different from what it is now, but there'll be important lines of continuity. And the reason it'll be very different is because, you know, The British era, for example, was clearly an expression of, I'm not going to forget France, that's why. But that system clearly reflected the outlook of European nations, the key European nation states of that period. Likewise, the period since 1945 reflects the American view of the world. And, you know, likewise, if China becomes, you know, the dominant, let's say, the key player, then it will reflect the way what China is. I mean, a nation projects onto the world what it is, how it sees the world, its own values. You can't understand the world today in the international order without recognizing that that is true vis-a-vis America.
So let's ask a real Chinese. What is the, how would you respond to Martin's question, or I guess query, that in the emerging international order, China will play a central role? Do you agree?
I should first respond to your question to Francois. I think the future of international liberal international order is uncertain. Actually, no answer at the moment. I should start by this logic. According to Alexander Winter, you know, he's very popular in China because the effort of Qin Yajin. you know, Alexander Winter is an advocate of constructivism school in United States. And because of Qin Yajin, he's very popular. Anytime he visits China, and considered as a star. And according to him, there are three kinds of IR, right? The nature is different. One is Hobosian, another is Rokian, and then Kantian, right? And actually, I agree with his logic. In my mind, the IR in 18th century, 19th century, dominated by European powers, in accordance with Hobosian culture. And the game at that time is European powers try to seize colonial of their own, right? And sometimes they fight each other. So the approach to stabilize international order, one is imperialism, second is balance of power, right? But fortunately, when U.S. led by President Woodrow Wilson into World Forum in World War First, U.S. not only changed its tradition, isolationism, not only desired the result of First World War, but the U.S. also reshaped the nature of IR. Then IR entered the role game. And then the game changed. The approach to stabilize international order, one is hegemony, second is violent power, and third one is very new, that's collective security.
So right? Where does China
stand? I still need three minutes to finish logic.
No, you don't have 3 minutes because,
okay.
No, this is not an IR lecture. We want you to tell us, the key question here, Jin Canrong, is this, how would you define the emerging international order, and then we'll go back.
We don't know whether there will be an emerging world order or just continue the current order. Depends on the situation like this. You know, because the local order offered a new game. That is, we do have universal norms, and then representative of this universal norm is the UN. And then we do have a world market. So the new game is that you don't need to have your own colonial, but you need to increase your percentage in the world market, right? So under this new situation, Rokian system set up, established by United States, then it's possible for Japan has a peaceful rising second time. And it's possible for China peaceful rise in the past 3 decades. You know, we don't need to occupy our neighborhood, but we need to increase our percentage in the world market. So in the future, I think whether the current liberal international order can survive depends on, first, whether China is still satisfied with current situation. What I can say is, up to date, China is very satisfied. China considers itself benefit a lot from the globalization. We don't want to change that. We encourage U.S. to play the role as a world policeman. That's very cost money. So we encourage U.S. to stay there. So first, whether China still satisfied. Second, I think it depends on the U.S. If U.S. can really revitalize its economy, now the U.S. economy hijacked by Wall Street, I think. The manufacturing industry still keeps shrinking. So if the U.S. can achieve what President Obama said, U.S. should revitalize the manufacturing and become a very confident, competitive power again. That's the two key index. Yeah. If China satisfies, if U.S. become competitive country, you know, then no problem.
To be quite honest, I think as a Korean, as you can see, I am not Chinese or French or English. But it seems to me that China benefits from the global international order, and yet you don't really assume a responsibility commensurate with your power at times. You criticize America for all these things that they do, and yet you don't want to take up, you know, responsibility on your own, whether it's Syria or Iran or any of the other huge problems that we face in the world. But as you were speaking, I realized that Francois had lots of disagreements with you. Am I right, Francois?
Yes and no. I was going to build on his. I was going to build on something that Canrong said when he did, you know, Hobbes, Locke, and Kant.
Yeah.
Who is Kant today? Well, the country we've been, and say that voluntarily in Korea, the country we've been berating for 2 days, the Japanese. Mm. Japan, since 1988, increased its overall military spending by 30% in 25 years. Who in the position of Hobbes? I'm sorry, it's China. Mm. The military budget has been multiplied by 11 since 1988. It's now 58% of all military spending in East Asia and South Asia combined. There's no arms race in East Asia because one country is ahead. I say that fully, you know, knowing that some countries have also increased their budget, but by far not as much. Mm. Second remark, I think Tanzong has just given us the reason why there is no multipolar order. Because what you're describing is a turn to a leaderless world. Mm. Because indeed, Jacques Martin may be right that China should lead the world, except that China doesn't want to lead, doesn't want to take the responsibility. It has the throw weight, and this is what we have to deal with. We have to deal with a country that's a global force, but that's a partial power. I'm also trying to reconcile you with another book that has appeared on the same topic. And China thinks it can ride on the coattails, can, you know, max out the benefits, as you've said. Sometimes it works, but if we expand the scenario 10 years or 20 years in the future, it just can't work. Probably it can't even work for China. It certainly cannot work for the rest of us.
Martin, I wanted to ask you a follow-up question. Do you believe that China has benefited from the international liberal order?
Without any question.
Okay, so why should the Chinese dump that particular order, which it has benefited from so much?
Well, I think that China's benefit, first of all, the reason why China's benefited is that once it was admitted, once it decided it wanted to be admitted to the global system and was admitted after a delay when it joined the WTO, then China has enormously benefited from a global market.
That's right, yeah.
And the relative stability of the world order during that period, which has, for which the United States, in broad terms, has got to take most of the credit. Mm-hmm. Now, the next question, sorry.
No. So, why should China disagree with the order that gave it so much since 1978?
Well, I think in a way, Francois is right, that as China becomes more and more important, a bigger and bigger player in the world, then the situation it's been in, which is, you might call it a free travel, you know, a free traveler or free loader, then that situation is unsustainable in the longer run, because China is going to become such an important player. Mm-hmm. It's going to have other interests. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, there's nothing unusual in this. Every rising power initially is an economic power. Yes. By and large, it's not a political power or a cultural power or even a military power. That comes later. Mm. This is historic, you know, this is Paul Kennedy, the rise and fall of great powers and so on.
Right.
As China becomes, you know, increasingly important economically, take East Asia. Mm-hmm. It's clear that in over the next 10 years, China, I would think, unless we're going to get heading for hell, China is going to become a major player in a new East Asian order. I think the United States will be part of that, but I think China, there will be some kind of parity between them. Okay. And in that situation, you know, then one's going to get changes in the way the thing works. I mean, you know, an order in East Asia in which China is predominant as opposed to the United States, which I'm not forecasting in the near future, but in the longer run, it's not difficult to imagine that situation, given America's economic decline in the region and China's economic rise in the region. that that order is going to look very different. You know, I mean, it's going to assume certain characteristics in a modern form of what it historically was, which was the tributary system.
I think that is both good news and bad news for Asians, right? But Jin Canrong, I wanted to ask you, do you believe that China's sustained rise is possible? That you will grow forever? I mean, you are already facing huge economic problems, right?
Yeah, I think China can still enjoy 20 years growth.
20 years of sustained growth. So what would you feel comfortable with, not you, but your leadership?
Yeah, I think the reason is very simple. The three basic economic elements still okay. Three economic variables: labor, technology, capital, right? No problem in the coming 30 years. We still own enough labors in the 20 years. And capital, no problem. Technology, we are very good learning, right? And the innovation, I tend to believe we will be an innovation-driven country 10 years later when our R&D investment surpass the United States. China will be very innovation-oriented country. So all these three basic variable, no problem. So we can still enjoy 20 years, 7 to 8 growth. That may, finally, China's GDP, I think, will be three times as the United States.
Okay.
Three times?
Why is that important?
Definitely, without GDP cannot fulfill all your desire, but without a GDP, you can reach nothing.
But why do you want to become a very powerful country? What is the ultimate goal once China becomes a great power or greater than it is today?
Yeah, that's very simple. People likes a better life. Unless CCP can ask people just to keep it quiet,
right,
not improve your life, then stop. But no, even God cannot stop the demand for better life for 1.4 billion population.
All right.
Nobody can do that.
I agree with you.
I mean, even when the Chinese economy is twice the size of the American economy, the standard of living of the average Chinese will be half that of the American.
That's right.
So, I mean...
Well, there are certain...
Eventually, if China had the same standard of living as the United States, it would be four times the size of the American economy.
Okay. But Jin Canrong, I wanted to ask you, as China becomes more powerful economically and so forth, I understand the domestic rationale. What are you giving the rest of the world in Asia?
Mm-hmm. I think a big difference between the China, U.S., and the Soviet U.S., the game difference is that China's country share the same similarity with United States. That's exceptionalism. U.S. exceptionalism.
My question was, what will you give to the rest of the world in Asia?
Then following difference is that, then both U.S. and Russia, you have a messianism, Then the logic is, we are the best, then you must follow me, or I will beat you. But China is a different story. We consider we are exceptional, and we want to achieve what we want. Then we just let you go.
No, wait a minute.
So you can have your own choice. No, that's none of my business.
You think China is exceptional?
Yes.
Why?
That's a philosophy. Just like the United States, you can ask the same question to the United States and France. All the country with...
So just because you're exceptional, is that good for Asia and the world?
No. That's another story. China, as I said... U.S. and USSR has two logic. We are the best, then you must follow me, right?
Don't look at Brad Glossop, although he is an American. My question to you is...
China's logic is that we are the best, and then the other word, none of my business, you can make your own choice.
We'll come back to this, but my quick question to you, Jin Canrong, is this. There are 14 countries that borders China, am I right?
Yeah.
Share borders,
other land.
Right,
land.
14
yeah.
countries.
Yeah.
And I think one of the greatest feats of Chinese diplomacy is that not one of them is a natural enemy of China. But unfortunately, in my personal opinion, not one is a natural friend of China.
Mm-hmm.
So who is your best friend in the world, in Asia? And why don't you have many friends?
Nearly all the big powers are lonely.
Right. No,
China
I asked
not
you.
Not exceptional case.
No, that's not true. Who is your best friend in Asia? You've been here for 5,000 years, so we want
Pakistan.
To know who is your best friend. Who is your best friend in Asia?
Pakistan.
Pakistan. All right.
Cambodian.
Okay, Martin, go ahead.
I think that this is actually a very deep question that yeah. you're raising here. And it's not answerable in any easy way, because it does require us to think very differently from the conventional ways we've been thinking about the world during the age of the West.
Yes.
And that's the problem with an easy answer to your important question. Now, the thing is that Jin Canrong is absolutely right that China is a very different kind of country. I mean, call it exceptional, whatever you want. It does share something, and this is the core of it in a way, it does share, interestingly, with Europe and then subsequently the America, which inherited a lot of European characteristics, was a sense of its own universalism. Okay, it was a model. But the way the two cultures have interpreted being a model has been profoundly different. The way the West interpreted the model was that, you know, starting with the colonial era, was a missionary zeal to convert the world to European values by colonization, essentially. Mm-hmm. And America's continued that tradition in many respects. You know, the requirement of to be like this.
Yeah.
Yeah? Now, China's very different historically because its universalism did not essentially lead it out of China. Its universalism left it satisfied with China within its own borders. I mean, of course, you're right. It had an international system in this region called the tributary system. But it was not a colonizing system. It was a hierarchical system, which was a different proposition. And I think that, you know, so for various reasons, China's sense of what it is not to convert others to being, you know, it's not like the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union wanted to convert everyone to those ideas in a Western style, whereas the Chinese are not like that. And haven't historically been like that.
So what do the Chinese want us to do?
Well, I don't think that they want you to do anything in that beyond a point. I think what we'll see, this is the great difference. If you want to see, well, what's a Chinese sort of world, you know, not literally a Chinese world, but, you know, a world in which China is the dominant player going to be like compared to the Western world? Well, I don't think, for example, that China is going to major on military expenditure in the way that the West has done. That, I just don't see that. There's no historical tradition. It's not going to ring the world with military bases and so on. I don't think it's historically a great political meddler. But it has two forms of power that it has been very important to it. Mm-hmm. One is economic. I'm thinking of the tributary system.
Right.
It was China's economic superiority. And that was so important. And if China rises like it's been rising and carries on rising, and I agree with Jin Canrong that this is likely to carry on for another 20 years, you know, growing, I don't know, 7%, 6%, 5%, but still a decent growth rate for 20 years, then China's going to have enormous economic power and leverage around the world, much greater than the United States has ever had. That's the first. The second one, which I'm not sure how to answer this question, but historically, as you know, living in East Asia, culture has been really the calling card of the Chinese, their sense of what they are, the sense of, you know, that Chinese civilization is the greatest civilization, you know, superior to all others, and so on. Now, there's no evidence at the moment that this is going to be a Chinese characteristic, but I wouldn't be surprised. You know, one of the great difficulties when people talk about, what are the forms of Chinese hegemony going to be? What a soft power. Well, the difficulty is that basically you need a very modernized culture to be like that, and China hasn't got a modernized culture, and it'll take time to produce a modernized culture. So that's how I look at it. Okay.
Francois?
I'm full of objections, and I've worked on China for a long time. I think what you're doing is being fascinated and mesmerized by China with its culture. Did you hear the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Korea at the opening talking about Korea's eminence and global role and culture? Have you heard Mr. Shinzo Abe talk about, I don't remember his exact phrase, about Japan's resume? It's one of the great problems of Asia now is that culture is locked in by these nationalist speeches and this nationalist revival. One of the things I've learned coming to the conference, this conference, which worries me most, more than anything I heard, something I read in an opinion poll by Asan on what do the Koreans think of their neighbors. There is a page that classifies Koreans by age groups on Tokto and reacting to the Japanese, and I found the toughest people are the youngest, and the easiest people, the ones who don't want to go too hard, are the oldest. That is the one who have the experience. We have a huge danger in Asia today of people being fascinated with their own success, being oblivious of the conflicts that have happened before. I speak as a European, of course, because we've lived through Sudan then. Coming back to the Chinese debate, and building in a constructive way from what San Jong says, I think there's been a debate in China on modesty, the role of modesty, with some people saying we have to stay low, and other people say, come on, we've got to show our head, we've got to be active. So I take what San Jong said as being more on the side that, you know, in the end, China has to play a role. And I think we do need China to play a role, because if it doesn't appear to, it is doing something anyway. On the military fact, which to me, you know, it's so basic, we'll meet in 6 or 7 years, and most probably, unless a drastic economic accident happens, at that time, the Chinese defense budget will be close to half of the Pentagon budget.
That's right,
excluding an accident, of course, also in the US about the budget, and we'll be talking about a different world. I don't want to project 15 years from now, of course, but just that simple fact has implications that go beyond intent. Finally, and a last remark, we are too obsessed by China when it comes to international order. It's very good that the Chinese focus on it because they have focused on themselves for a long time. But hey, what about the Indians, the Brazilians, the Turks,
Mexicans.
The Mexicans, the Indonesians? These guys are democracies. These guys often disagree with us. They, one thing they've learned is how to say no. That's very clear. And that's where the West doesn't rule anymore. But A, they don't agree among themselves. They don't agree with the Chinese. They don't agree on a new set of norms, even less than you know, China might have, at least its vocabulary on norms. So I'd say the software hasn't quite transferred yet. And if there is a will on our side to participate, if there is inclusiveness, we still have a chance to shape the next version of the liberal order, which indeed will no longer be led by the West.
But it need not be anti-West.
I don't think the rest will lead the West to fall for the old joke. But we also need to work to be accepted. We did inherit quite a few stories, which you have reminded us, and we need to atone from that. That's why
going back to my original question to you. As China becomes more powerful, this is it's a fact, right? Mm-hmm. Militarily, politically, culturally, scientifically, technologically, etc. Mm-hmm. What good will you provide to the rest of the world? What is it, that special flavor that you call the exceptionalism that China has? How should Asians and other parts of the world feel as China becomes stronger? What will we gain from you?
Mm-hmm. I think China wants to be rising within the current international regime. Mm-hmm. China wants to be a member of a board of trustees. And actually, I think we are a member already.
But not chairman.
Not chairman yet. but with our investment increased, with our share increased, we need more votes. You know.
Okay.
So we're bound by the norm of a board of trustees.
Right.
But according to the norms itself, with our investment increased, we need more voices.
Okay, what voice will that give? Let's say you have 30% more vote, okay, in this imaginary group that runs the world. So what will you then, what will be the Chinese voice? How will it be different from the American voice?
I'm not sure at the moment, because you know China itself is on the change, is in the transformation. In the past 3 decades, the most important change in China is that we have an absolutely new state-society relationship. Used to be we have a very strong state versus weak society. Mm-hmm. But now state is still strong, but the society become much stronger than before, right? And what's the desire of the future civil society? We don't know. So that's one uncertainty. Perhaps another unexpected variable is that if EU can revitalize, get a success, we have a better arrangement. Perhaps mm-hmm. we can have, theoretically, we have another choice, right? But we suppose EU not that successful. So we're still living with the American-centered order.
Yeah, but with all due respect, Canrong, you have, mm-hmm. you have not answered my question, which is what benefit will you give the rest of the world in Asia that we don't have today?
Okay. I think the largest market to the world. I think in 3 years, China will surpass U.S. As the largest import market, right? That's something very sure. The total volume of trade surpassed U.S. last year. And in 3 years, our export will surpass. Then in 5 years, China will be the largest investor in the world, you know? And then...
So it's all about money?
That's one part of the story.
Okay. but I'm sure there's more to being chairman of the board, Brad, than just giving money, right? Right, Francois?
A footnote about this, I can envision a world where there would only be two economic powers. One would make virtual objects and do quite a lot of rent-seeking with Google and Microsoft and so forth. And the other one would be the king of material objects. Mm. And it's China's capacity to shrink their cost nearly to zero. Not quite zero, but very low. It's an extraordinary complementarity. It's the real G2. Mm. It's the real problem that the rest of us have, by the way, economically.
Yeah, but that's not going to carry on. I mean, that's the division of labor at the moment. But the whole purpose of the new economic reforms in China and so on is to begin to move up the value chain.
Yes, hopefully.
And there is lots of evidence already in China, in, for example, East China, Shanghai area, in Guangdong and so on, that this is taking place. And, you know, and China is beginning to lose some of its most labor-intensive manufacturing, both to Africa and
Martin,
to parts of Asia.
You posited a trajectory whereby the Chinese economy will continue to grow, at least the next 20-plus years, right?
Mm.
Okay. What will Europe do then, and the rest of the world? Will you guys just sit back and write more books and do nothing about this? Or, I mean, innovation is... Americans are still innovative. Europeans are still innovative. Germans are, certainly. The British are, the French are.
So what's the question?
The question is, will Europe just stay behind while China rises? Won't Europe also be responding to this change? Won't they change the way they run their economies, become more efficient, more innovative, more creative?
Well, I think there are two questions here. The first is that China's rise, like America's rise in the second half of the 19th century, will have enormous economic benefits globally. I mean, I'm not saying that in all cases it will be win-win, but nonetheless, you know, when you've got a market rising that quickly, then
everybody rises.
There are many benefits. Yeah, large numbers of people rise, and I mean, you know, of course, some sections lose out in a country, and other sections gain. You can see this in America. Mm. But take Africa. You know, I think China's been a very important factor in the big increase in the growth rate over the last decade in Africa, because it's bid up the prices of commodities. So that's the first point. That, you know, but at the same time, you know, take Europe. Well, clearly, Europe's got two problems. No, probably more than that. But we'll start off with two. The first is that. It is its share of global GDP is declining.
Is declining, okay.
And this process is going to continue. And Europe is going to become an increasingly less important player in the world. This is a very important thing to say.
It's a different issue.
It's an important thing to say. At the same time, clearly, Europe faces a problem of a growth model and a political model at the moment. It's been very, very slow to recover out of the financial crisis. You know, it's now, what is it, six years since the financial crisis. So the question is then how Europe finds its new place, you know, and its new focus. I mean, it's easier to see America's economic future than it is to be...
Francois, you had a two-finger.
Yeah. At the same time, of course, I agree with Martin that Europe has many problems. That's an easy start. But I want to look at it in an unconventional way. We are experiencing the wrenching pain of economic integration. Part of Europe suffers. If we look at the Eurozone as a whole, and the Eurozone, not necessarily with the UK, which is a different unit, we probably currently have this largest current account surplus in the world. The current trade surplus is also largest. I mean, it's not far from the US Treasury labeling some of us currency manipulators in spite of the of the euro going up. So let's not exaggerate. What we have is we are not a state. So we are subject to pull and push, pull and tug, how the English expression goes. In terms of hard power, we are behind the curve, and this is becoming extremely important in our neighborhood, especially because the US no longer fills completely the gap, and that's demonstrated by recent events. And we need to face the political consequences of this wrenching economic integration. I want to also point my difference with something I heard yesterday. Somebody said, well, nationalism in East Asia, nationalism in Europe, you know, it's only normal. We're not talking about the same thing. We have populism, which is a reaction against big government, federal government, if you will, in Brussels, integration. Have you noticed how our far-right nationalist groups in Europe, they form a common parliamentary group? Do you think that people in East Asia would do that? Form a common parliamentary group? Quite the contrary. Same words, different meanings. So that don't, you know, look too harshly at Europe, because yes, it's still an experiment, but some aspects of the experiment are actually working very well.
Jin Chen Rong, I wanted to ask you a question that has nothing to do with the subject in a direct way.
Yeah.
And the key question is Russia.
It over tea.
So if you take the Ukrainian crisis and what's happening on the Crimean Peninsula, do you believe that Russia is on the rebound? Will Russia be a factor in the creation of a new world order? And in that new world order, if Russia is a resurgent power, how will you cope with a resurgent Russia?
I can only express my own observation. You know, many people in China, they have some special complexity with Russia. They, especially those old people, you know, they are teenager, many learn from Russia. So my personal opinion is that it's very difficult for Putin the Great to
Putin the Great. So you think
really shape Euro-Asia Union, and his weakness is that he's not very good to import market economy into Russia. You know, actually Russia, blessed by God, the per capita resource is really good. And Russian people very good, beautiful girl, handsome boy, very good. The human resources, the natural resources, very good, blessed by God. But the problem is that they waste that blessing. You know, if you have a very competitive, effective regime to use up this blessing, great power. But I don't see Putin
well,
very
I don't know,
good.
Do we have a Russian in the audience?
No, we don't.
All right, so you won't be sued. but honestly, Martin, I wanted to ask you, do you believe that Russia, number one, is a resurgent power? And if she is, how will that impact the emerging order?
You want to start?
Yes, to Martin. Yeah.
Martin.
I think Russia is no longer a global power.
It's not.
Not a global power.
So you agree with Obama that Russia is
a regional
power.
I agree. I think that is basically correct. And the reason is what Jin Chen Rong has said, which is that you know, the Russian economy has been, you know, leaves a hell of a lot to be desired. You know, I mean, it lives off its raw materials, it lives off its wealth of commodities and so on. Its manufacturing capacity is very weak. It's failed in a way that China succeeded. Yeah. I mean, and the collapse of communism, the collapse of the Soviet Union, you know, didn't make things any better. Unfortunately, you know, there was the terrible period of Yeltsin and flogging
so it off. So, what is your quick, I guess, forecast for the reign of Putin the Great? Not my words, but Canrong's.
Well, I've only got two thoughts. One relates to a question you asked this morning, actually, which is, you know, I think that Russia, there's a sense of grievance in Russia about what's happened since the collapse of the Soviet Union. They think that they've lost. You know, this is their perception of the situation, and they've been humiliated. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I don't want it's a strong term to use, but call it mini Versailles problem. Yeah, that they have a grievance about the way they think the hand that was dealt with dealt.
I haven't heard that, but it's very, very good.
Mini, it's good, Versailles, isn't it? Mini,
it's
Versailles.
Very good. I'll quote you next time.
It's yours.
Okay, all right.
You
okay.
can have it. Claim it yourself.
Okay.
But I understand that, and I think the West did overplay its hand in relationship to Russia, and we've got a problem now. On Putin the Great, I love that expression. I bet you're going to claim that one as well. and he's not a mug. He's not the thing that most shifted me on Putin was on Syria, and the article that was written under his name that appeared in the New York Times. This was, you know, a very, very smart intervention, first-class intervention. Mm-hmm. And then the way he's handled the situation on crime and so on, you know, he is not a fool. Mm-hmm. And he should not be, you know, his capabilities should not be underestimated.
Francois?
We should never forget World War II. We should never forget that the Soviet Union desisted from power by itself. Mm-hmm. Gorbachev, Yeltsin. This is something we have to remember. And that's where the feeling of humiliation comes, because they haven't really been rewarded from without by what happened in 89 and after. So I think we understand that. On the other side of the scale, frankly, there is no gold, there are no uranium mines, there's nothing in Transnistria, in Moldavia, in Crimea, in eastern Ukraine. Mm. It is a shake-up for the sense, the postmodern sense of smugness on the part of Europe, that there is some conflict at its border. Mm. But the reality is that it's not world-shaking, except it's going to mean an added drag for the Russian budget, added problems economically. And I think that's what I'm looking at for the future, the sustainability of this new kind of policy. I have no doubt that in the short term, he's going to be rewarded electorally. Let's never forget that it is a sort of presidential democracy, but people do vote. And so there is that element. In the midterm, I think he's going to run into a lot of problems, because frankly, Russians don't want to choose between the West and what I would call despotism.
Do we have a microphone in the audience, Isaya? Let me just put my friend on the spot, Doug Paul. He is not only a dear friend of mine, but he is a very well-known geopolitical leader. He used to work for the U.S. government. He was senior advisor to President Bush. Reagan or Bush?
Both.
Both on East Asia. He was the U.S. representative in Taipei, and he is now vice president at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. So let me just put you on the spot, Doug. Has the prevailing international order, what dividends has it given to the world and to Asia in particular?
We've had this discussion, in fact, yesterday in one of the panels. There's a long list of the post-World War II benefits that have flowed.
Right.
I always start from fundamentals, which is, had, for example, East Asian countries, small countries, been left to the law of the jungle, they would have all been in arms races Singapore versus Malaysia, Indonesia versus Singapore and Malaysia, and other and the Philippines, all kinds of things would have been going on, and that would have been writ large in Northeast Asia.
Right.
But the United States provided the kind of security blanket that allowed everyone else to reduce their defense expenditures, focus their energies on development. And that's mm-hmm. that's the big story okay. of the public goods that came from the post-Cold War order. We now face the big challenge of whether that post-Cold War order will meet the needs of a more dominant and demanding China in its relationships with its neighbors and with the United States. And I think the answer to that is not yet clear.
Okay. I think, Brad, you had a comment as the second American that I can see from the audience.
A comment and a real quick question, but Martin said, you know, the decline of U.S. GDP relative to that of the world, sign of the decline of the U.S. and the undermining of the world order, and I would suggest that is, in fact, proof of the success of the U.S. order. It is precisely the ability of the order to sow the seeds of its own destruction insofar as it creates opportunities for everyone else, it creates political power and economic power that is, I don't know, a paradox, an oxymoron, whatever you want to say, but if you wish to look for what would be a mark of success is ultimately that it seems to kind of level everything out in ways that it creates challengers.
But Brad, as Asia becomes richer, not just China, but the rest of Asia, why do they need you?
I mean, that was my second question was going to be, you've talked about a world order, what happens if we create regional orders? And I'm wondering the impact of it is, but I don't know if they do need us. And I guess that becomes the question is, do they, create a system in which we all seem to recognize, do we have empathy, to use Paul's words, do we have empathy such that we recognize the value of ensuring everyone has the same opportunities and a shared stake in the system, and isn't based on the exceptionalism such that only large powers have certain privileges? And while it works out that way, at least in theory it doesn't.
Okay. Let me go back to constructing a new international order for our panelists. One of the key questions that's been burning for the last several years, is whether so-called Western values are universal values. And so my question to you is, one of the, I would argue, benefits of a liberal international order is something we would call universalism. And I'm a big fan not only of democracy, but universal values, quote unquote. I believe that Asians can be free and wealthy and responsible. So the whole idea that the so-called Asian values will somehow, you know, stop or curtail the level of freedom, I disagree passionately with. So my question to you, Francois, is this, and to all our great panelists, is universal values dead with a declining liberal order, or will it outlive whatever we have in the world today?
I have a mixed answer because I think the theme is overused and abused in different categories. Today, that's why I think I started by saying there's regulatory fatigue for the liberal order. Yeah. There's just much ambition, too many areas where we want to achieve standards. Mm-hmm. It's also reflected, by the way, in culture. Mm-hmm. And I think there should be a balance between what is global and what is local. I'm not suggesting return, you know, to customs, Asian and Western values, the Malaysian proverb for running the country. But I think there has to be a balance. This being said, I note that you look at the success of a country, of an economy such as China, which of course is the global factory, and notwithstanding the conflicts we have with them about indigenous innovation and, you know, some barriers behind the customs which they create, they absorb literally 90% of global norms within their systems. They're crucial parts which relate to the political and the judiciary system, which they don't absorb. But all the rest comes in, literally. And one of the big gifts of, and one of the big talents of the Chinese in the fact that they are not a great wall, they're a sponge, and they filter, but they take in. So if only for that reason, I think universal values have a great future. We may end up thinking about protecting endangered species, so to speak, and local, values more than we need to protect universal values in many
areas. So on the whole, you're fairly positive it will outlive whatever we have today.
Yes, and I don't confuse that with supremacy of the West or with supremacy of the U.S. or Europe, of course.
Very,
this is
very
a different
point.
Issue.
Martin, what are your thoughts?
First of all, I did agree with your point. That was very much. I think that universal values is a term which is bandied around a bit too easily, especially for the West. I mean, first of all, a lot of the values that we associate with Western values are actually historically not necessarily derived from the West. I mean, if you look at Ashoka, India, if you look at what happened in in the most advanced part of the Middle East and so on, then many of the values that we associate with the West actually had antecedents in other parts of the world. And I think, you know, notions of tolerance and so on. I mean, Ashoka, India was far more tolerant when Europe was being, you know, incredibly...
repressive.
Yeah, repressive. Yeah. So I think that it's very important to see this in a fluid, multicultural, and relatively malleable sense, you know, that you can't freeze it. I mean, the trouble with these debates is they easily get frozen, don't they? But, you know, right. Fundamentalism, I mean, you know, Tea Party or in one, you know, part in America or wherever, you know. So I think that's very important to recognize. Secondly, I think it's very, very important to recognize that, you know, the only people who really, when I think of the values debate, it's most of the protagonists are Western. And then you get a sort of response, which was that Asian values argument for Mathieu and Lee Kuan Yew. Now, I never bought that, to be honest with you, because I thought it was self-interested vis-a-vis the struggles of those nations at the time. But I do recognize, and you know, someone like Lucien Pai is very good on this, you know, that the values in, say, Northeast Asia, or China, including China, obviously, or looking at it in Southeast Asia and different societies, they do have distinctive values which are different. You know, the role of the family, the relationship between the family and society are very different in those cultures to what has happened in the West and so on. Now, you know, so you can't just say, well, there's just these values and they're Western derived and so on. I think it's much more complicated. Likewise, you take the place of the state. I think a lot of the misunderstanding about the question of the state in China is to do with the idea that the sole source of legitimacy of government is democracy. Now, I certainly used to think this myself.
But no longer.
No, not in anything like that simplistic way. Because it's clear that the Chinese state does enjoy great legitimacy. Mm. It does. I mean, of course there's a lot of protests and, you know, and mass incidents, as they're called, and so on.
Right.
But, in fact, if you look at the Pew Global Attitude Surveys or the work of Seisha at the Kennedy School and so on, there's the Chinese state enjoys a great deal of legitimacy. Now, then you have to say, well, why? How? Then you have to look at Chinese civilization, the evolution of the state, the relationship between the state and society. And that has echoes, more than echoes, in Korea, in Japan, and so on, because they have certain shared civilizational heritage. Now, rather than saying glibly universal values, I hope what we're moving into an era is that the best of what the West has offered will be joined by learning from other cultures, other histories, which basically, let's face it, in the age of the West, have been ignored.
Okay. Jun Tan Rong, same question to you. What is the future of quote-unquote universal values?
I think from the perspective of average people, anywhere, finally what they demand is high-quality governance. Well, I use another term, good governance.
Well, how would you define good governance?
And good governance means accountability, transparency, and participation based on rule of law. But unfortunately, past the two decades, people use another term, democracy, individual freedom, and with romantic way, not scientific way. So to some extent, I think...
What do you mean romantic versus scientific? I'm confused.
Not strategically not strictly defined and relating with the daily life of people, but more in accordance with the interests of political leaders.
Those so you're saying that so there's
ambitious
a,
political
there's
leaders.
There's a difference of how people see democracy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still confused.
Okay. I think most time in the past two decades, this term, good term, democracy, individual freedom, be used by many Western politicians, media, and academia for strategic purpose.
What do you mean?
So demoralized among Chinese public.
To demoralize the Chinese public?
No. This kind of romantic definition of democracy.
Why is it romantic to have the ability to have free speech?
Okay.
As a Korean, I am very proud mm-hmm. to criticize my government if it does something wrong. And I am sure that my friend Yoshi in Japan is also rightfully proud of Japan's democracy.
Okay, the third wave democracy involved around 120 countries, right? And only 10, very few, Korea is one of them, can be say passed the examination, qualified. Nearly 110, they failed. Ukraine is a case, Thailand, Uruguay, Venezuela, you know. So how you justify your instruction? You lead people field, and you said, I'm right. That's democracy romanticism.
So are you telling me that Venezuela under Chavez or the late Chavez practiced democracy?
I think most of the participate everywhere, including those people believe in Arabic Spring. Mm. They very simply import the concept from West media and try to do it, and it leads to the disaster. Mm. And nobody came out said, I will respond for that. Right?
Well, for example, if you have the genocide in Syria today, would you agree that that the Assad regime has killed over 150,000 Syrians?
Mm-hmm.
Because he wants to maintain authoritarian power.
I don't know what will be the answer.
What? No, as a human being, do you believe that it is okay for a government to kill nearly 200,000 people? Yes or no? This has nothing to do
definitely
with international order.
Definitely is no. But the reason, who should take more responsibility?
No, I'm asking you as a humanist.
Mm-hmm.
And in this in this era of great prosperity, I think we should care about the fact that in this corner of the world, there are people being slaughtered by that government.
Yes, but also by the rebellion, the same. We don't know who will take responsibility. Actually, the Commission of Human Rights of UN, they said both sides should violate the anti-human.
Well, I'm sure the anti-Syrian forces have also violated, some rules.
And let me take another case, Rwanda, just last week.
Yes.
We celebrate the 20th anniversary of Rwanda, and France refused to go, right? And that's an immediate result of Western version of democratization.
No, I disagree with you. Because the
who
West...
Take the responsibility?
The UN and the US and Europe and Asians failed to prevent the genocide in Rwanda, where 900,000 people died within a few months by machetes. That was a big scourge on the world. Everybody has to take the blame. Bill Clinton did, the UN did, the EU did,
France did,
and everybody else. We commemorated the 20th anniversary of this sordid chapter in human history. There's nothing to celebrate. We all failed.
I don't really understand where you're going with your line of questioning, because you take the you're saying well. Of course, where the way Assad has handled the situation has been awful.
Right. Okay?
There's no. I'm not arguing about that. But what you do about it is a much more complicated issue. Why is it more complicated? Mm. Because this is about serious ethnic differences.
Yes.
Okay. So it's between the Sunni and the Shiites.
Yes.
And it's become also a regional issue because there is intervention not just from what Assad's doing, but from outside as well, from Qatar, from Saudi Arabia, and so on. So this is a complex issue.
Yes.
There was, now, one way of handling it is Western intervention. Mm. Look what a disaster Iraq was. Mm. That was, you know, the scale of deaths perpetrated as a result of the American intervention was a disaster. Mm. So, we know, of course you're right. All these things are bad. You know, who's going to say that they're good? They're awful. Mm. But how to deal with them is a very complex question.
Martin, I agree with you 110%. My question to the panelists was this. Whether it's Syria, whether it's any other huge, you know, complex issue that we face today, whatever order we have in the world today, somebody must assume some type of responsibility, whether it's the UN, whether it's individual states, or whomever else. We simply cannot let Syria just slide by while more people are being killed. I think that would be a really, really sorry chapter in, you know, in world affairs.
But, you know, that's pious, isn't it? I mean, what, you know, concrete, sure, if we can find a way of doing something about it, good. But clearly, you know, we've seen demonstrations of how not to handle things by external intervention, you know, usually involving the United States. A lot of those things haven't worked. Not always, but generally, I don't think they've worked. And the reason they haven't worked is because the intervention from outside is often misguided in its purpose and poor in its implementation.
Francois?
The danger with the humanitarian line turned into a policy is that intervention carries its own peril. You know, what you say could apply to the system that's up north from here in humanitarian terms, yet we can't do it, we don't do it, nobody does it. I want to focus on Rwanda because I'm French and the French were trapped and caught in this disaster. The reason they didn't go to the celebration was that Kagame, the president, who at the time was at the head of one of the two groups fighting each other in Rwanda, accused the French of having participated into the genocide. The French have acknowledged a responsibility in having been advisors for one of the two groups and probably having failed at that time to sound the alarm bell soon enough. But they made up for this by intervening militarily on the ground and doing their best to separate. At a time, remember this was, I believe, the Clinton presidency. This was a time when Clinton had been very frustrated and, for example, gave up on Somalia. So it was a very difficult time. And that's exactly the situation you're trapped in. Mm. The Chinese answer to this is very simple. If a civil war doesn't carry a risk for international peace, it doesn't spill over international border, let it carry on. We won't do anything about it. I don't think we can carry a liberal order with this premise, but it is true that every time you intervene, you run very great risks. And one of the problems is you overstay. That's the most classical problem. What you said about Iraq, even now, I don't believe it. We haven't seen what would have happened had the situation gone on. We have seen the disaster of a post-US intervention situation which hasn't solved everything, which has left many people dead. We haven't seen what would have happened under the other circumstances. Mm. Perhaps we're now seeing with Assad what happens.
General, you had a two-finger.
Yes. You know, China sent more peacekeeping troops than any other permanent members, right? So that's one thing. Second is that, as for the tragedy in Syria, who should take responsibility? I think whoever behind the civil war should take responsibility.
Okay. Now, we have only about 8 minutes before the session comes to a close, 5 minutes. All right, so does anybody have a burning desire question to one of our panelists? Yes, can you please identify yourself, make it a short question, and then we'll have one of our panelists answer it.
I'm Suhan Lin from the Institute for National Security Strategy. When we talk about the liberal international order, we have to think about the basic value of liberalism itself. That's about the individual rights and liberty. And when we take this scale on put on the East Asian countries, South Korea and Japan is quite liberal, but less liberal than Western democracies. And when it comes to China, let me excuse, it could be a liberal society yet, but we have an anti-liberal state in our region, that is North Korea. And As long as there is an anti-liberal state in this region, I think we need liberal leadership.
So what is your question?
Not the question, just a comment.
All right. Yes, Paul? Can somebody give Dr. Evans a microphone?
Thank you. It's been a fascinating discussion. And a question in one sentence. In 1948, there was a Universal Declaration on Human Rights. Mm. If a Universal Declaration on Human Rights were written in the year 2014, would it be any different because of the power shifts that have been described in the presentation so far?
That's a good question.
Okay, let's go in reverse order, and then we'll have a final comment. So make it very quick.
Mm-hmm. I think the general principle should be same, but we'll add something, how to achieve that general principle. You know, you cannot put same demand for a millionaire and a beggar, right? Mm. So you used to be overlooked, neglect these differences. But if China stamp in, China will put these new elements in. Okay.
Martin?
You haven't got a copy of it on you, have you? Probably it would be, there'd be changes. And there'd be changes, I think, for two reasons. One, because one would want to reflect a greater plurality of cultures and their experiences. And secondly, because in the last, 60 odd years, we found out a lot more about the developed societies as well. For example, the position of women, the problem of sexual abuse, gay rights, I would imagine, doesn't have a place in that. So, yeah, I think for a variety of reasons, probably. But my remarks are subject to having a look at it and reminding myself.
François?
I agree with Chan-Jong that there would be more about implementation, but from a different perspective. In 1948, if I think of the UN, the only really working organization was the refugee organization funded by the UN. Nothing else was really functional. Today, international organizations exist, NGOs exist, and I think this would have to be fit in. I disagree politely again with Marta, because I think that there is a danger in the inflation of human rights and norms, in the enlargement and I think it's part of the debate we had about the differences in liberalism. I would like a broad gauge, and I would like, shall we say, norms to be kept to a minimum which can be followed rather than, you know, developed to infinity where they break down.
Okay. You have 1 minute each to conclude, and I literally mean 1 minute. So, Canrong, what are your final comments?
Okay, as a scholar, I definitely hope you can be successful. Then perhaps we have a better choice. But as a, strategist, researcher, I have to say in the near future, we have to stay in the current international regime.
Okay.
No other choice.
Okay. Martin?
Well, I think my main feeling, listening, you know, being part of the discussion and so on, is that I've enjoyed the open-ended character of it and the willingness to, you know, play around with these thoughts in a very open and open-ended way. I think that speaks well, actually, for this kind of exchange. Because often there's a presumption that somehow the existing order is eternal. And I'll tell you one thing, nothing is eternal, and certainly not international orders.
That's right. François?
That was a very good conclusion. So I think what I should add is that we have to diversify. Yeah. We have to be careful about moralizing. Mm. We have to be able to take in lessons as well as sometimes give lessons. I did enjoy the debate with you, Tanjong, and with you, Martin, for those reasons, because I think we avoided that. Ultimately, by the way, it still gives reason to my argument that the liberal order can endure, because if that's precisely out of this kind of exchange that you can build a movement forward.
Well, thank you very much. I'd like to thank the audience and to two people that I put on the spot. Thank you very much, Doug and Brad and Paul for your comments. And to our three great panelists, Jin Canrong from Renmin University, Martin Jacques from Oxford University, Cambridge University, and Francois from Godement from Sciences Po. And I thank you, Martin, for giving me that term, mini Versailles, which I will now abuse as my own thought. So thank you very much.